Davidson Show. John's co-host for this week is the talented television and film star, Richard Crenna. Their guests today are Academy Award-winning actress, Olivia de Havilland. Captain Kangaroo himself, Bob Keeshan. The comedy of impressionist, Fred Travellina. And the musical talent of Rupert Holmes. Ladies and gentlemen, John Davidson.
A minute. What is all this racket over here? No! Haven't you ever seen a show before? What?
Not John Davidson.
Oh. We're so glad you came by. Any busloads from any place special that you came in from? Where from? Antelope Valley. It's Lancaster. Of course it is. People watching across the country probably don't know Antelope Valley. Antelope Valley is where Trigger is, right?
No!
Oh, Apple Valley. That's right. Okay. Listen, we have a much better show than this. We have Richard Crenna, Olivia de Havilland, Rupert Holmes, Fred Travellina, and Captain Kangaroo, Bob Keeshan. Stay with us. Be right back, okay? In addition to being such a successful, having such a successful television career, my co-host this week has made his mark in motion pictures well. You saw him in such pictures as Sand Pebbles, Wait Until Dark. Welcome, please. Our co-host, our special guest for this week, Richard Crenna, is here today. John, you're beginning to steam me now.
Why?
This is the third day on the show, the third time you've taken the song I was going to sing.
You don't sing. You're kidding me about that, right?
Well, if I was given an opportunity, you know, but I didn't. No, it's all right. You can sing. I'll let you open the show. It's your show,
John,
after all.
John, start to... again. Take John... it easy. Take it in the same key that I did it in. Take it easy.
Going down the road, down the loosen my load.
Wait, leave me alone. Leave me alone, John.
You don't do rock and roll, do you?
No, actually, I'm more into waltzes and nice, quiet things. Quiet. Very subtle things.
Are you a quiet person? I mean,
basically, I guess I am. Yeah.
You seem quite conservative. You don't seem crazy.
Not really entirely crazy. I used to be considered crazy when I was younger, but I'm more conservative now as I get older.
Yes. Your wife, Penny, must love that stable nature that you have. The man who is never emotional or rants and raves around the house is always smooth.
John, listen, you forget I'm Italian. I hate to keep bringing this up, but I am Italian. I'm not smooth around the house. I do a lot of ranting and raving. But I guess it's not, that's the nature of, I guess, the Latin in me, is that I let it all out very fast, and then I relax and fall asleep.
Speaking of Penny, you and Penny, you always throw those zingers in. I'm already on to the next. You were dating for 5 years before you got married.
Yeah.
Why did you do that? Were you afraid of getting into that conventional thing of marriage?
Well, you see, for both of us, it was the second time around.
Yeah.
And we had both had an unfortunate first experience, and I think we were a little bit cautious about going into another relationship. And she was going after you. Folks don't remember this, but there was a radio program, Helen Trent. And Helen Trent, you remember that?
Sure.
Well, I wanted my wife to go after the Helen Trent record for, because they had a suitor for something like 22 years on radio and never got married, you see. And I was trying to break that record with Penny. But I had a fever one night. This is absolutely true. I had a fever. I was about 103. I was delirious. And she brought me chicken soup. And I proposed to her. Absolute truth. I proposed to her.
In a moment of weakness.
In a moment of weakness. And I was also sick of driving to her house, which was a long way from mine. Really.
You now have a daughter. I think she's 15. Is that right?
That's right.
How are you raising her? What do you say to a 15-year-old daughter nowadays about this crazy life that we lead?
Well, she sat me down and she told me about the birds and bees. Well, it was nice of her to do that. I'd say I think it's a tough world to grow up in at this point. I really do. I think it's very tough because I have three children, you know, and this is, Maria is the one on the end. We have one 28, and then we have Richard 21, and Maria at the end. We were on the 7-year plan. We just worked it out that way somehow. Just lost our heads every 7 years.
It is true, though, that for teenagers nowadays, there are more options, there are more problem spots, and there are more challenges.
I think so. And I think that, but I think that the young people today are a great deal brighter than we were at that age. I really do. I think they're a great deal more exposed to things. Maybe not brighter.
Exposed, that's
exposed
all.
To things, right. and more aware of a great many things that we weren't in my day.
Is she dating at 15?
Yes, she is. Yes.
Many people don't let their daughters date until maybe 16, maybe. Is that old-fashioned?
Well, I don't know if it's old-fashioned. I think it depends a lot on the child.
When the guy comes to the door.
Yeah.
See, my daughter's 7 now.
Yeah.
Here comes.
Well, John, I don't want to give you advice at this point. I know I'm a little old. I would suggest that she didn't start dating until she was about 8. You know what I mean?
No, that's not what I'm saying.
Oh.
When the guys do come, when she gets to be 15, 16.
Yeah.
And the guy is not your idea of the perfect male.
Oh, isn't that awful?
I don't know yet.
Oh,
what
well,
is
you'll
that
find
like?
That's awful. It really is terrible. It's awful. The guy
How can you say to her, look, this guy's a schlep?
Because every guy that comes to the door is the potential, he's the potential provider of a grandchild. And I'm looking at him, and I'm sizing him up, and I'm looking him over, and I'm saying, hey, this guy, he's too short. This kid is really too short. The hair is receding. I don't want a kid born with no hair, you know.
What would you tell her about choosing a guy, if she would listen to you? Well, what sort of ideals in choosing a man?
Well, I want my children to be happy. I think that's the one thing that I could wish them.
That's too general.
Is to find happiness.
Of course you would.
It is too
general. Everybody says that. Be more specific.
I would want it to be very rich. No, I would expect him to be very considerate. If I see her involved with a young man, and we have to call him at that age young men.
Yes.
With a young man who is not considerate, who is kind of self-involved.
Let's
I begin
it,
to
the,
worry about
the most
that a
exciting
bit.
Teenagers to the girl, the most exciting guys are the guys who are not considered.
Flakes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because they're living life, they're going for it. They're
That's true. And it's very difficult, you know, how do you, you know, we can sit here and be very profound at these at this moment, but it's very difficult when you're actually faced with that problem and you look at a guy and you say, this is a nerd.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know what.
Well, I guess the best thing you do is what you've done. You've shown your children as much of life as you possibly can.
Hopefully,
you,
yes.
You travel with your kids on
all
your European trips as well.
All the time.
You spent
yes.
9 months in China with your children, or with how many of your
That's
kids?
Right. Well, Maria, as a matter of fact, the one we're talking about now, I did the sand pebbles, and Maria was 3 months old, and we bundled her up and took her off to China, and she was there rolling around on the carpet. She doesn't remember it, and it really peeves her every time we talk about being in Taiwan and Hong Kong, and of course Richard and Shauna, the older children, they really kind of put her down for not remembering it. And at age three
months.
It's 3 months, it's a little tough, you know. But I've always felt that I wanted my kids with me as much as possible. In this business, it's a very tough thing. We're gone so much, and we talked yesterday about television and why I left television for a time, which I did. And the decision was conscious at that time, mm-hmm. to spend more time with the kids. And I was able to take them with me on
locations. I must tell you, as far as traveling, I've had a big fight where my kids go to school with the principal and with the superintendent, because I feel that travel for a child, if you don't overdo it, is as good an experience as going to school. And we've taken our kids out of school for major trips whenever we want to.
Yeah. Well, I had the same experience with my children, and I went to the school and I said, look, I think it's more important that my kids know that they're loved than that they learn math at this point.
Mm-hmm.
And
we'll get in trouble for saying
want
that.
Well, yeah, but I think children have a way of kind of catching up anyway, because my kids were always behind in school as a result of that, and always had to kind of catch up. When they were in Hong Kong, for example, they had the decimal system.
Yeah.
They had to come back, and then, God, they were hit with new math. You know,
yeah.
I mean, good luck.
Yeah. Your daughter, if she's watching the show today, is going to go crazy with our first guest. Do you know why?
Oh.
Because his name is Rupert Holmes, and he'll be right back after we take this
yes.
spot. I don't know how it was when you were in school, but when I was in school, everybody said if you're a music major, if you really study music and get degrees in music, then you can't be a commercial success. Rupert Holmes is a good guy to dispute that theory. If it's talking about pina coladas or talking about the answering machine, he's had major records, him, so many. Would you welcome the multi-talented, educated musician, Rupert Holmes?
A little while ago, place to call to tell this girl I know that she could have it all. The wedding, the ring, the whole dumb thing. I was willing to tie the knot, so I called her up, and this is the answer I got. I'm so sorry, you have just reached my answering machine. I'm not in at present, I'm sure you know this whole routine. Leave your name and number, and I'll try to get back to you. You have 30 seconds to talk to me before you're through. And I said, baby, let's go get married. I need to know your mind. I am hanging on, I am hanging on, I am hanging on this line. And the phone went dead. So I stepped out to buy some dog food for the cat. Of course she called about 3 minutes after that. Would she be my wife and share my life? Well, of course she can write the plot, 'cause she called me up, and this is the answer she got. I'm so sorry, you have just reached my answering machine. I'm not in at present, I'm sure you know this whole routine. Leave your name and number, and I'll try to get back to you. You have 30 seconds to talk to me before you're through. And she said, baby, I got your message. Why I'm answering your call. I have thought it out, and I think that all in all, if you ask if we can marry and make it for a time, then
song went, I'm so sorry, you have just reached my answering machine. I'm not in the present, I'm sure you know this whole routine. I'm so sorry, you have just reached my answering machine. I'm not in the present, I'm sure you know this whole routine. I'm so sorry, you have just reached my answering machine.
I apologize for kidding you about the name Rupert.
It's a rough name to remember, but once they get it right.
Who would name their son Rupert?
A mother who was in a bad mood that day.
What's your middle name?
Sherlock, if you will believe it. No, not really.
Rupert?
David.
Oh, Sherlock Holmes.
Yes,
I see why that would be funny.
Yes, it would be.
Not necessarily.
No, never. No.
Rupert.
Listen, Rupert's a nice tall person, too, and he has money. I know he's doing very well. How do you feel about young girls?
I'm looking around now.
I mean, you wouldn't want to name the firstborn Rupert, though, would you?
No, we'd have to reach some arrangement. I wouldn't do it to anyone again in my life. I've spent a lifetime putting up with Rupert.
He's trying to fix you up with his daughter.
Oh, is that it?
We're looking ahead.
Oh, that's
Rupert,
great.
There are several things that are different about you that are I find you fascinating.
Yes.
First of all, you look... A music major. You don't look like you sound on the records.
I'll try and from now on, you know, put a big, large hole in the middle of my head. I don't look like my records. Yes, I don't know how to deal with it.
What does that mean? That's right. You've said in some of the articles about that you look on a record, and there's something a little offbeat about all your records. They have a little bit of like I went out to buy. Cat food for my dog.
Dog food for the cat. Well, people do that sometimes, you know. I think that I like to tell story songs. I like to write about... I don't write about the cosmic canyons, or the smoke rings, or the echoes, or the distant visions, or the purple crimson shadows of your mind. I write about tangible...
I'll say what.
I like to write about tangible things.
Real things
that people know, because then they can relate to it, find themselves in the songs.
And things that have happened to you.
Oh, yeah, unfortunately, yeah, a lot of them.
Yeah. You said that a record is a movie on vinyl.
Yeah.
I think that's a great statement. Have movies been made of your records?
No, we're negotiating to make a movie out of Escape, you know, the Pina Colada song. That would be the departure for an entire film. I always felt that if you tell story songs on record, see, I think it's enough that they're movies on vinyl because it allows people to make up the pictures themselves.
Mm-hmm.
So I love to tell story songs because that way, if I talk about the bar called O'Malley's where we'll plan our escape, the bar is what you envision it to be, not what I envision it to be, and then it becomes your song. So I think it's enough. I would be satisfied if my movies stay on vinyl forever and people supply the cinematography themselves.
Speaking of movies, you're also a TV and movie buff.
I love it. Oh,
I know you
to
know
sit
lots
next
of
to
trivia
this man, so.
about
he is.
Give us some trivia about, just very quickly, and we have to break away, about Aramis Brooks.
All right, well, there's nothing trivial about Aramis Brooks because it's a great series. Of course, obviously, Walter Denton here on my right. But, for example, Robert Rockwell, who played Mr. Boynton on the show, he was the original Jor-El, that's Superman's father, on the very first episode of Superman.
I didn't know
the Marlon Brando role he did on TV. And plus, after Aramis Brooks, when he left the series temporarily and then came back on again, he had a series called Man from Black Hawk, in which he played, of all things, it was a Western about an insurance salesman. If you can imagine that. Can you imagine selling Wyatt Earp a policy? No, you put a loser.
You see, that's a whole other side of you that is also fascinating.
It's demented.
Speaking of movies, you know who's coming out next? Olivia de Havilland. Olivia de Havilland when we come back. We'll be right back. Our next guest is one of the grand ladies of film. I don't know whether they make ladies like this anymore. I wish they would. She's received 5 Academy Award nominations, 2 Oscars she's won. I think one of her biggest roles, for me anyway, was Melanie in Gone with the Wind. Would you welcome, please, Olivia de Havilland.
Thank you.
What a charmed life you've had. I've been reading all about you this last week, knowing that you're coming on the show. Of all the awards and all the honors that have been bestowed on you, what are you most proud of in your life?
I have two children. And they're what I think are the greatest achievement that one could wish for.
Wonderful.
I have a son. He's a mathematician, which surprises me greatly. I have trouble adding one and one, and two is beyond my capacities, but he's a mathematician, and he's at Lockheed in Sunnyvale, mm-hmm. the great aircraft
sure.
firm. And then I have a daughter from my second marriage. She's half French, an American citizen, and she's a lawyer.
Wonderful.
Yes, and...
I think she's in our audience,
she
one
is
of the most
right
attractive
in...
lawyers I've ever seen.
Marvin Mitchelson,
yes.
You must admit.
If your children meant so much to you in your career, how have you kept career and family straight all through the years?
Well, I was lucky, you see, because I went to live in France, and my son was about 4 years of age when we went to France. He was from my first marriage, and then I married a Frenchman and had my daughter by him. Well, I lived in one place geographically, and that was the place where I had my house and my children and my personal life.
Yes.
And then I would fly back to the United States and make a film, and that is where I would have my professional life. So neither I could concentrate when I was home on my personal life without any intrusions from the professional life.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was here working, I could concentrate on my professional life and the piece of work I had to do.
A place for everything and everything in its place.
That's it. Exactly.
Buck Owens does that with Bakersfield, but it's not quite the same.
But the principle really
the
is
principle.
The principle
is
the same.
In your career, are there some roles that you've turned down that you could just kick yourself now for missing?
Well, there were two I wanted to play very much, which went to other actresses. Now, that's different from turning something down, but I did want very much to play in the Nun story, and it simply never came my way, but it went Audrey Hepburn's way,
yeah.
And she, I am sure, did a beautiful job. I never did see the film. But I then there was another one, Anna and the King of Siam, which Deborah Carr
yes.
did,
yes.
and that I did see, and she was absolute perfection in it.
Yeah.
Absolutely marvelous. Now, neither of those roles did I turn down. There was one I did turn down, which will surprise a lot of people. It was Blanche in Streetcar Named Desire.
For heaven's sake.
And I had just given birth to my son Benjamin when that role came along. And I thought, of course, that he was the second coming of the Messiah. Of course, it's the Virgin Mary. It would have been very unsuitable for me to play Blanche Dubois. I couldn't relate to that part.
That would be very different from the roles that you've done, wouldn't it? Wouldn't Blanche be very offbeat for you?
Well, yes, I thought rather offbeat.
Yes.
But naturally, a wonderful challenge, and I love variety in
sure.
work anyway.
It would be a challenge.
And Elia Kazan was going to be the director, and I would have had full confidence in him.
Yeah, sure. You represent to me the grandness of film heroines. Isn't it true that in today's films we seem to be celebrating the characters that women are given to play are either uneducated people or lower class people who are fighting to overcome some tremendous obstacle, or people that are not cultured people as you are? Is there a change in films? Are there fewer roles that would be exactly up your alley, so to speak?
Well, there seem to have been fewer
there
roles.
There is a change, isn't there?
Well, I don't know. I, frankly, have not seen too many films recently, so I can't talk too much about it.
For example, The Great Gatsby.
Yeah.
Now, that
mm-hmm.
came out as trying to revive that glamour and that the grandeur of the beautiful people. seems to me in our contemporary films, we don't thrive on seeing the beautiful, cultured people walk around with lots of money and all that. We like to see someone groveling.
Well, listen, they walk around with no money at all sometimes.
Maybe that's what's changed. But those films don't succeed. That's what I mean.
What I was wondering, is it that the film doesn't succeed, or is it that magic mix of people that makes something work? For example, you know, you mentioned Gone with the Wind, John, and I've looked at a lot of pictures that I saw as a very young man, and I thought they were wonderful, and I've later seen them and said, what in the world did I see in that picture? It was awful. Gone with the Wind, every time I see it, I look at it, and it was just as good as I remember it the first time. It holds up today, and it was a magic mix of people. Those people were just so wonderful. You were all so fantastic in that film.
Wasn't that film, though, Gone with the Wind, a result of the Depression, that people wanted to fantasize and see some beauty on the screen?
That's possible. It was written and published in 1936, but there's also something else involved. It's very curious how pieces of literature come out just before some immense crisis, bigger than the Depression, for example, and that was the coming war. And that story, after all, has a universal theme. It is about the defeat of the South and its renaissance. And yes. So it was a film that prepared one's mentality in a curious way for war, even for defeat, and even for survival. And I know that in France, for example, which was a country occupied by the Germans for so many years, there were copies of Gone with the Wind, not the movie, of course, but the book, which were circulated among people. And it kept their spirits going. You don't know the number of people French people who've said that to me. You cannot imagine what the story of Mélanie and Scarlett and Rhett and Ashley meant to us during the occupation by the Germans.
Because they were survivors.
Oh, yes.
They were all survivors.
But they were an occupied country, just like the South, you see.
Right.
They were invaded and occupied, and they survived, and their renaissance is now complete.
Yes. And you've had so many wonderful films since then. Thank you for sharing a little bit of your life with us today. We have to break away. Fred Travellini.